So you have, once the colonies was being set up in America, you have Morocco first acknowledging the colonies, or acknowledging America as being, you know, a sovereign, you know, country. You have the Treaty of Peace and Friendship between Morocco and these people in America. And this is what a lot of the Moors speak to. So understand one, while you were enslaved, while Africans was enslaved, while we was being, you know, raped and tortured and beaten, you had the Moors walking around as these intelligent people who basically, you know, was free and allowed it to happen.
And then in the morning, and bigger on the horse.
Everybody's staring at
me. They ain't never seen no nigga on no horse before.
I know many of us have read some books or some literature that perhaps gives a bad name for Moors. There's many types of Moors. We represent a pure and clean nation, meaning that we can actually stand without experiencing a so-called wrath. We didn't enslave anybody. There are Moors. Or those pale Moors. We're not talking about those Moors. We're talking about the Moors born here in this country here. Right? Now, most people will argue that, during the time there was no nationality during the time, but during the time before nationality was the order of the day, there was a thing called tribes. A thing called empire. I encourage you all to study those things. What it is that we're trying to demonstrate with you. And no, we're not trying to convert anybody, because we understand that some people are going to die being black. But honestly, how can you truly give honest to your ancestors calling yourself a name that they did not consider themselves?
Say that again.
How can you give honest to your ancestors, right, and they did not consider themselves black?
It's
something to think about. I'm not coming here to come and tell you or teach to you or anything. I'm giving you some things that plant in your mind so you can go home and do your own diligent study, because we understand the science that man knows not by being told.
It's wrong.
See, a lot of people getting caught up in how smart some of these people seem to be, but you're not paying attention to exactly what they're saying. So they'll claim, well, we wrote the Constitution. They stole it from us. Okay. We did all this and all that and everything we did with these people, and they stole. We was in America first and blah, blah, blah. What the hell were you doing while we was enslaved? So while we was enslaved and in chains, these people was mingling with the slave owners. It was the Moors who taught these people how to build. It was the Moors who taught these people how to lay out Washington, D.C. and more, laid out Washington, D.C. And the Moors taught them how to build Capitol building and White House and everything else. It It was the Moors that taught all this stuff. The Moors taught them so much information, gave them so much information, wrote the Constitution according to them, and put so many things in place as far as the powers or the let's just say how America was going to be run by these Europeans. The Moors claimed fame as how they set all this stuff up. And what I want people to understand is to step back and don't fall for how smart some of these people may seem and what they are saying. You need to look past all that and understand that how can you sit there and say that you was in America before these people and that you taught them all this stuff, and during this time you teaching and you doing everything that you're doing that you claiming, but we was enslaved. The rest of the black people was enslaved. And you see some pictures out there where even some of the human zoos, you had Moors there. You know, when you see these black people, you see that fez, you know these are Moors. Plain and simple.
What would dumb niggas say?
So it wasn't no slaves walking around on the plantation with no damn fez on or with no damn turban on. These were Moors. These were the traitors. These were the people who basically gave them information to help them enslave us.
In antebellum America, African Muslims in antebellum America. If you log into Amazon, you'll see another book with the same title and the same author. That is the condensed and summarized version. Get that one because it has very good pictures in it. But the original, I think, is his dissertation. And that's probably your library has it. I haven't found it being sold. I've been wanting to purchase this for a long time. The original is huge. The one on Amazon is like 150 pages. It's a summary of the work of his thesis and added other chapters and stories as well. In this book and other books, you hear of quite a few people who were Muslims. He documents them. One of them, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq was his name. And he wrote his autobiography in Arabic, which is still available, in 1834. Very long, I can't quote all of it. Listen to this though, and this is the part really and truly it affected me when I read it for the first time. And I can only summarize it. The faith of our families is the faith of Islam. You see, you sense the pride. This is what he's starting his autobiography with. This is who he is. I am a Muslim. The faith of our families is the faith of Islam. And then he describes how he got captured, that he was literally, as I said, walking along and a bunch of guys comes and kidnaps him. And next thing he knows, he's in the blindfolded, thrown into a ship, and his arduous journey to America, etc., etc. He goes, that was the beginning of my slavery until this day. I tasted the bitterness of slavery from them, i.e. the Christians. He's talking about the Christians. And its oppressiveness. But alhamdulillah, all praise be to Allah, under whose power are all things. He does whatever He wills. No one can turn aside what He has decreed or ordained, nor can anyone withhold what He has given. As Allah Himself says, this is an American slave writing in America, in a manuscript that is still found in America, preserved in its original that he wrote in Arabic, which is he's writing to himself. There is nobody else to communicate with. There are no other Muslims he can write to. He's writing this to himself, and this comes, we come across it after he dies. We know what he says. Now we can read it. Back then, nobody knew Arabic. As Allah Azza wa Jal himself says, and he's quoting the Quran from memory. He doesn't have a Quran. There are no Arabic books that he happened to take with him the day of the journey. He's quoting the Quran from memory. As Allah says, قُلْ لَنْ يُصِيبَنَا إِلَّا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَنَا هُوَ مَوْلَانَا وَعَلَى اللَّهِ فَلْيَتَوَكَّلِ الْمُؤْمِنُونَ He quotes the verse in Surah At-Tawbah. Say, nothing can happen to us except whatever is written for us. قُلْ لَنْ يُصِيبَنَا إِلَّا مَا كَتَبَ اللَّهُ لَنَا هُوَ مَوْلَانَا Allah is our Lord, therefore in Allah let all of us put our trust. Another very well-documented slave is Ayyub ibn Sulayman. And he's probably the most well-documented slave of all. He was captured in Gambia in 1731, but because of his histories, he left in Gambia. I really wish somebody could go and take up his story from there, because from our standpoint now, he's cut off from our world. I have to go on quickly because time is running short. I have a lot more actually prepared. I have to summarize. As I said, there were many people. Of them, again, I want to mention a few. Of them, and then one of the most interesting is a slave by the name of Bilali Muhammad, who died in 1857 in Georgia. His master was a very tolerant master. Believe it or not, he actually, as a slave owner, he wanted to abolish slavery. and he was campaigning to abolish slavery. And at his death, he included in his will all of the slaves should be set free. He purchased an original batch of slaves, not slaves who had been already working in America. He purchased an original batch, fresh off the boat, literally FOB, fresh off the boat. He purchased a fresh batch of slaves, 300-400, and he took them to his plantation. And it turned out that the ship had come from perhaps Senegal, perhaps Gambia, so a good percentage of those slaves were actually Muslim. And because he was so tolerant and so liberal for the time, he actually allowed them to practice Islam on his plantation. And a good percentage of the current descendants of that region, it's called the Sapelo Islands, the island which is right off the coast of Georgia, and this rich plantation owner owned the entire islands. So he had given, he had purchased all of these slaves to basically take care of the island and you know, get the cotton out and do all of that. He has an entire group of Muslim slaves. And this person, Bilali Muhammad, when he died, a little manuscript was discovered in his room, which he thought was his autobiography or something like that in Arabic. So he donated it to the museum. This manuscript turns out to be an original work of fiqh, detailing for the people of the island, the Muslims, their laws of the Sharia, how to fast, how to pray, how to do wudu, etc., etc. And it is based primarily on the Risala of Abu Zayd al-Qayrawani, but it is from his memory.
Now what happened was, they were supposed to get whatever they were supposed to get, and they got double-crossed by these colonists, by these Europeans, and they mad about it. So this is what all this stuff is about today. They're walking around saying they did this and they did that, but all it is Moors trying to get you to join their side and say you are a Moor. How come we wasn't Moors when we was enslaved? They want to say, no, you're a Moor. No more. We wasn't Moors when we was enslaved.
If you throw us tall as a tree, and I will still be your grandmother. And you will still respect me. Do you hear me?
I hear you, grandmother.
And do you understand that you do not know everything, cannot do everything, and that Allah is still considered greater than you?
Wrestler, I am a man, a warrior.
Kunta. We have been chained in the white man's canoe house for many days now. Allah see.
Go back. What you doing?
Where you go quick then? White folks don't like that kind of praying. And sooner or later, you're gonna have to forget that African stuff. Make white folks mad and scared, nigga.
Y'all wasn't screaming that shit when we was in slavery that all these black people were Moors, you gotta set them free. Nah, y'all was too busy trying to cut a fucking deal.
You know what I realize? Ignorance is bliss.
This is the Burrow House, a plantation home in tiny state Burke, South Carolina, about 10 miles west of Sumter. It has been the site of many Forrest Gump-like moments. General Thomas Sumter lived here, former Governor Stephen Miller lived here, Joel Poinsett, for whom the poinsettia is named, died here, even Samuel Maverick, whose son became the namesake for the term independent rebel, owned this house on the property.
A lot of really important but not splashy historic people have wandered through here.
Perhaps the quietest of them all has arguably the most important story to tell. It began here in 1935 when three young girls discovered a stack of letters while playing in the basement of this home. Those letters, now held at USC's Carolinian Library, tell the story of a slave named April.
There's been a really good job of whitewashing a very awkward discussion.
It's a hugely awkward discussion.
In 1802, a white plantation owner named William Ellison lent one of his young slaves, April, to work for a gin maker in Winnsboro. April quickly became the go-to man for repairing the expensive cotton gins throughout the Sumter area.
They send him out to the plantations and they take them apart. He would sharpen them on location. And that's why he heard about Stateburg. He came through here as a young man, and you know, he said, well, when he bought his freedom or whatever, he came here.
The center of plantation country, the wealthiest area of South Carolina. He changed his name. April was now known as William Ellison, the name of his former white owner. His gin business prospered. He bought this home, hundreds of acres of land, and eventually 68 slaves to work that land. Granger McCoy now lives in the Ellison home and says he often finds old cotton gin blades.
What do the Ellisons say when they come?
They're looking for the home place.
All descendants of what many of us thought an impossible oxymoron, a black slave owner.
I had a black ophthalmologist come through here, Ellison, and we sat on this couch right here. And his great-great-granddaddy owned 68 slaves, and here I am, white, over here, and my great-great-granddaddy didn't own any slaves, and it was like somebody blew a dog whistle in a kennel, and I was just kind of turning the head, not knowing how to handle all this.
History tumbles you.
I have to come back and tell my people they finna fuck us. When you go home into your 2012, understand they already have concentration camps in the United States of motherfucking America that they've been building for 4 years now. And the question is, who in the fuck is you finna put in there?
The King Alfred Plan. This program actually details the arrest, detention, encampment, and extermination of the black and Hispanic or Latino population of this country.
I was too busy trying to cut a deal. We wasn't Moors when we was in bondage and being hung, and y'all was out eating lobster and shrimp or what have you, and dining with these fucking white folks and living like kings while we was in bondage.
After this, we'll see if you break eggs again.
John Brill!
See some.
Where they?
That's Big John. That's Little Raj.
Where's Ellis?
He's the one hightailing it across that field right now.
Sure that's him?
Yeah.
Positive?
I don't know.
You don't know if you're positive?
I don't know what positive means.
It means you're sure?
Yes.
Yes what?
Yes, I'm sure that's Ellis Brittle.
Ellis!
But they want you to say or to believe that you was a Moor just like they is, and you got some kind of stake of claim to America. All you got to do is follow these rules and do these certain things with the legal system, and America just going to accept you as one of the elite or some shit. Come on. Now, the Moors got a lot of information about, you know, how to appear at court, you know, what the whole court system is about, how to address the judge and what to say or what have you. And all that stuff is all well and good. But any real conscious person is not trying to, you know, deal with this system at all, you know, in any kind of capacity. And being conscious is not about trying to conform to this system that has basically been destroying us, but how to get rid of the system altogether. That is our ultimate goal, not to just, you know, say that I'm a Moor and try to conform and fit the system that's a system that's, you know, crooked. If they want to accept it, they'll accept it. You know, all the stuff that you kick in the sand in court, if they want to take it, they'll take it and say, well, you know, it's the law. What moral code or what kind of code is going to bond them to accepting everything that you say when these people have stolen their position? So they're obviously thieves and they have no honor. So why would we expect them to just follow, you know, what we're saying because we said it some type of way in court?
I don't have a name. You don't have a name. Christians have names. I am a Moor. Okay. Moors have titles.
You don't have a title that you're called by then.
Let me say this. Let me say this, ma'am. The only one supposed to identify themselves is the person who has my child. And there's rules and law. You gave an oath to secure my inalienable, unalienable constitutional rights. You can play the police authority game with you if you want to.
I'm not playing the authority game. I'm asking you some questions.
And I'm letting you know, where's your delegation of authority order from Congress, certifiable and in writing on the public record? Where's your affidavit of fact? Where's your affidavit of fact?
My affidavit, how about my oath of office? It's probably on file with the county. I'm not sure where it's filed at.
Okay, so you're letting me know you're a party to this, to piracy, and you're kidnapping my child, human trafficking?
No, we're bringing your child back to you, and we're trying to...
I've been seeing European children walking around here all day. No one's picked them up. They said my child has not breached the peace at all, but they picked them up. So I'm letting you know. Yeah, you are useless. Mm-hmm. I have the right to speak. It's a beautiful thing to know the law. It really is. And I know that you're outside of law because you're acting outside of constitutional fold of government. And then we can talk about international law violations. See, before I've been kind where I always drop it and I leave it alone. But now that's piracy, human trafficking, treason, Universal Declaration of Human Rights. No one shall be arbitrarily deprived of a nationality nor the right to change one. My child is not Negro, black, or colored, and so he is not under color of law. Your little 1724 Christian black codes, baby. I understand it very well. That's where your policies come from.
Why do you keep bringing up the color thing? Because we don't care.
That's color of law. That's how you enforce color of law.
White male, black male.
That's how you enforce your law.
Uh-huh. Way too many videos of problems, but you're not black. Remember, we only kill black people. Yeah, we only kill black people, right? All the videos you've seen, have you seen any white people get killed? You have.
I don't know what's in his heart. But I certainly know what came out of his mouth.
That shit don't make sense. You know, it sound all well and good until you in that position, and then, you know, they might let you out that courtroom, but you don't know what's going to happen after that. You know, you too smart. You might tell somebody, and they might be worried about that. Now, next thing you know, you're dead. You shot, or some kind of accident happened because you was in the courtroom saying too many smart.
Hell out of here. Y'all's just some cowards is what it really comes down to. You know, and again, you know, we know that there's a slave mentality why they're a coward. They're not personal cowards, but, you know, they've adopted the crisis of not having an identity.
So I talked about before, one, how when you look at the inner understanding of the Moors, how it goes back to Islam, and how we can look at the Shriners, which is a part of Freemasonry, and how it goes back to Islam, both wearing a fez, and how we can look at the KKK, and how it translates into Islam.
These are photos taken at George Washington National Masonic Memorial Museum in Alexandria, Virginia. These are fezes, Moorish fezes, with Moorish names imported in the fezes. The Europeans have named their shrines. There's 191 ancient Arabic orders of the nobles and mystic temples. 191, and every one is named in our honor. Everyone has a Moorish Arabic name. They know who we are. So, what, you know, how do we prove that we're Moors? You know, how do I go to my oppressor, the one who conquered me, conquered my ancestors, oppressed us? You know, how do we go to him, you know, and tell and prove to him that we're Moors? Your concepts are wrong. The question is colorable.
So basically what you have in Islam is the codes of what they use to build, to understand about science, about physics, about astronomy, what have you, all coded in these books, which is why, as I said before, when you go into every Masonic lodge, you're going to find a Quran, a Torah, a Bible, because all this stuff is hidden in there. So when you see these so-called, you know, Moors and these Shriners walking around with those fezes on, this is what they really speak to. They ain't praising no damn Allah as being a god. Deep down in the inner core, they know what they're talking about. They know what they're doing. And for you Moors, wannabe Moors, who think that you're just going to jump onto the Moor bandwagon and be with the Moors, and you're a damn Mason, you're part of the KKK. Plain and simple. Cut this.
Okay. So people, you have to know and understand who you are and the opposition. Okay. If you don't, always you will fail. Okay. I suggest to study. You know, I suggest studying. I suggest to put your emotions in your back pocket. I suggest you to know who you are, where you are, and anyone that's not on the same trail that you seek in your journey, I say that you dissociate yourself with those people, okay? You came in this world with you and your mother, and when you leave and out of this physical form, most likely it'll be by yourself. With those thoughts in mind, research, don't take any of my words, research, use common sense, operate from your heart chakra, understand who you are again, where you are. Never judge a book by its cover. Understand that you have structures, principles, and morals by the opposition. Okay? They have an agenda. And necessarily today, they don't, again, walk around with the white hoods, lynching. It's a entirely different form of what they call slavery. It's on paper now, okay? It's on paper. The hoods are off. The do not, for colors only and for whites only, and do not drink at this water fountain. That's not in existence anymore, okay? They don't blatantly put these things out anymore. It's more, everything is more of a disguise.
To prove to you that the world is aware of your ill and bad, and the world is aware that you're really Muslims, your forefathers were. And Muslim ain't somebody, you know, doing some rocket shit stuff like this. You know, it ain't because you walk around circles and bang your heel, all that's ritual, that ain't really it. You've been played. Noah Drawley said, you know, before I brought you your name and your nationality and the knowledge of your birthright, nobody was talking to you. Nobody was telling you anything. Everybody was living off your virtues. And now that he brought your nationality and your birthright back and gave it to you, explained it to you, set up a foundation, an institution by which that information can be dispensed, now everybody wants to tell you what Islam is, what Islam is not. He said, they didn't tell you anything before. Don't let them tell you anything now.
Because see that,
because
go ahead.
We have no problem with accepting the good, the bad, as Moors. Our people, they only want the good stuff of what our people do. They don't want to accept the BS that we did to each other, right? There's no denial about that. Now, when you talk to European historians, Europeans will tell you that they would rather be under slavery to the Moors than anybody else. So what does that mean about Moors enslaving people? If Europeans are going to tell people that, well, the Moors enslaved people, but when you were under slavery to the Moors, you lived in the castle, you got showers, you got food, you would walk around and stuff like that, you had access to libraries, you could read stuff and all that. It wasn't some slavery like what people have in their mind of what slavery is when you are under slavery of the Moors, right? And again, when you do the geographical mapping of the slave castles, where they took the slaves from to go to these quote-unquote transatlantic slave trade, whatever that people want to talk about, all those castles are in African places. And the argument that people bring is that Africans aren't Moors. So that means, okay, so Moors didn't have the slave castles. Africans did. Why do they keep talking about Moors and slave people when the castles where they took people from were Africans? But they don't want to go there, do they? They don't want to bring that up. They don't want to bring up all these African kings that came out and made apologies to all these Negroes in America for putting them into slavery. It's all the stuff on YouTube. Just research it.
Now, in 1999, Mateo Curacao, as president of Benin Africa, came to the United States of America to do three things. The first thing is to apologize. The second is to seek forgiveness. And the third thing is to seek reconciliation for his country's participation in the African slave trade. Did anybody hear about that? Ladies and gentlemen, this is the head of state of an African nation who came to the United States of America to apologize for his country's export of 3 million of their own people in the African slave trade, and nobody in the United States of America has heard about it.
Maybe we should ask the Moors.